too, for coming out. And I really want to express my appreciation for having this conference on today to deal with the issue of black power. Because we think that that is the fundamental issue of these times that we live in. But in fact, it's been the fundamental issue for African people for a very long time now. First of all, what I would like to do is just briefly say some things about the African People's Socialist Party, which is the organization that I chair. We are a revolutionary organization. And by that, I want to say that we are convinced that this country, this system, do not have the ability to do justice by African people. That if we are to ever know justice, freedom, and democracy, we are going to have a revolution. It's that simple. And I know that that's a difficult issue for a lot of folk. And the fact that it is obviously a difficult issue for a lot of folk is reflected in the number of people who are in this room right now. But it is nevertheless the truth. And it's important to talk about that because we can continue to have discussions that make us feel good, but won't take us anywhere. We can continue to have discussions where people come before us and make rhymes like up with hope and down with dope, and perhaps we'll feel better, but they don't take us any place. And what we have to do is come up with some kind of analysis of the reality that we are confronted with as a people, and then be able to use that analysis to change our circumstances so that they are not the kind of circumstances we find ourselves confronted with today, but what we want for ourselves and for our children in the future. So we are a revolutionary organization. We believe that if one wants to know what it will take for us to become free, all we have to do is look at history and see what it took for us to become enslaved. And if we find any place in our history that we voted ourselves into slavery, then I say, let's go and get together and vote ourselves the hell out of slavery. And if we can find any place in history where we sang our way into it, then let's sing our way out of it. But the reality, that is not the case, sisters and brothers. The reality is that we are going to have to cut, shoot, and bomb our way out of the circumstances that we find ourselves confronted with. And I know that's not something that everybody wants to hear, and it's not something that a lot of folk want to hear. But it's the truth, nevertheless. This is not a suggestion at this meeting that once you on your way out, we're going to be handing out AK-47s for people to go out and do your thing. Reality is I'd be extremely afraid to pass out AK-47s in the community because I'd be afraid that I'd probably become one of the first victims of the AK-47. In other words, there's a lot of work that we have to do in the interim. But having said that there's a lot of work we have to do, we have to also remember that our objective is total, absolute liberation for our people. And you can't have it any other way. There's no way that you can talk about sharing the power over your lives with somebody else and then feeling like you got a right to complain about what somebody does to you. Either you want the power or you don't. And some people are afraid of the power, and some people are not afraid of the power. In fact, actually understand and believe that we need the power, but just don't believe we're going to ever be able to get the power. And so what they will do is find themselves compromising forever with a system that has never been able to bring anything but genocide and oppression to African people, as opposed to struggling to find some way to end our relationship with this North American hell that we've been confronted with for something like 500 years today. So we're a revolutionary organization. We're a revolutionary organization that was founded in 1972 at the back of the attack on and defeat of the Black Revolution of the 60s. The Black Revolution of the 60s was one of the most consequential things that has ever occurred in this country, and it's something that we have to struggle to understand. All of us need to struggle to understand. And we need to understand it because subsequent to the defeat of the Black Revolution of the 60s, there's been a lot of historical revisionism that's been occurring in this country. And what we find is today people tell us that the 60s was not about revolution, but it was about the flower children in Haight-Ashbury and San Francisco making love and not war. They tell us it was about hippies. Or if they want to, if they find themselves talking about African people in this country, what they suggest is that perhaps it has something to do with a generational thing, that a few young people were caught up by these mysterious times and got involved. And they even sometimes suggest that maybe somebody put something in the water and all of us went a little crazy. But the reality is that the 60s was a period that was characterized by the Chinese as an era upon which, within which there was great disorder under the heavens. And the reality is that revolution was the main trend in the entire world in the 60s, not just in Philadelphia. But everywhere in the world, oppressed people had risen up and were fighting for their freedom. And they were fighting all over Latin America. In fact, the 60s were open with the great revolution in Cuba in 1959 that overthrew a U.S. Puppet government under Batista, where the U.S. Held Cuba as a whorehouse for white people and a gambling den for wealthy white people and gangsters and what have you. It was Cuba that opened up the 60s. It was, we saw the 60s see in places like Uruguay the rise of the Tupamaros who tried to make revolution there but were defeated. We saw in the 60s in Nicaragua, the FSLN, other revolutionary forces who rose up and initially were defeated. In China, the great cultural revolution opened up. In Africa, we saw revolutionary movements in places like Guinea-Bissau, Angola, Mozambique, South Africa, what have you, peoples around the world fighting to be free. And in this country, we saw revolutionary uprisings as well. And they manifested themselves sometimes in forms like the Black Panther Party and the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee and other revolutionary formations which existed throughout this country. We are a part of that era. And our organization was born at the time when the great revolution, Black Revolution of the 60s, had been defeated. And that's an important era that I want to say something about. I want to say just a little bit more about the 60s because I think it's something that we need to sum up. Because most of us don't understand what the 60s were about. And even those of us who struggle for some kind of honest analysis or assessment of what that era was about, most of us don't understand what it's about. And I want to just say something about it because I think it has a lot to do with our situation today and how we understand the task before us right now. First of all, the 60s as a revolutionary period was given rise to by various changes in the structure of the world economy. And particularly what I'm talking about is as a consequence of the Second Imperialist War, which is too often referred to as World War II, and where people tell us that it was a war that was fought for democracy, but which in fact was an imperialist war where everybody engaged in the war was bandits. And in fact, everybody engaged in the war was involved in a process of trying to redivide the world. It was a war to redivide the world. It was a war where Germany, having felt as a consequence of the first imperialist war, which also was a war to redivide the world, having felt that it had lost most of its possessions, its colonial possessions, and even part of its territory through the Versailles Treaty, had struck out to dominate the world. And it was a war where England, which at that juncture was characterized as an empire upon which the sun never set, was defending its interests, and it was a war which, as a consequence, saw Europe, the economic infrastructure of Europe, destroyed or nearly destroyed, and the same thing happening to Japan, and resulting in the United States leaving that war as the most powerful country in the world. That was the basis for the rise, the immediate rise of U.S. imperialism, devastation of Europe, and then of Japan. And what came as a consequence, because the war was not fought on U.S. territory, but was fought throughout Europe and was fought in Japan, we saw the world monetary system move from England, where it had been previously, to the United States. And we saw what had previously been colonies of Europe and Japan now becoming colonies or neo-colonies of the United States, where now the United States had penetrated most of the former colonies of France and England and Holland and the rest of them, whether that was in places like Nigeria or Cameroon or India, what have you. Now the United States was involved in contesting the power of European imperialists for control of the economy of most of the world. Same thing was happening in Asia. And so as a consequence of this imperialist shakeup, now the U.S. had a greater, and I want to just say one other thing about this, because we get fed a lot of fairy tales about the Second Imperialist War, and it's something that African people cannot tolerate. Because again, we get told that this war was something about democracy and fighting for democracy, but it was a war that occurred at a time where lynching was a national pastime in this country, lynching of African people. And it is a war that I want to say something because today we hear people making statements like the United States government currently is acting like Nazis or something to that extent. But the reality is that the Nazis had nothing on the U.S., and certainly it had nothing on forces like England. And what has happened as a consequence of the Second Imperialist War is we have come to understand in the world that the worst crime in the world has been committed against white people by other white people. And that is the murder of the Jews that happened in Europe, and particularly in Germany, has been characterized as the worst atrocity in human history. In fact, it was so serious that up until the Second Imperialist War, the 1940s, there was no such term as genocide. The term of genocide was something that was created to define what Hitler had done to the Jews. That's an extraordinary thing, given the history of the rise of imperialism in the world, the history of the rise of capitalism in the world, that saw Leopold from Belgium kill from 10 to 20 million Africans in the Congo alone. Given the fact that when Columbus came, when he first landed in Haiti, there were 8 million Indians there. 4 years later, there were only 3 million Indians left. Given the fact that when white people first came to the Americas, there were more Indians in the Americas than there were white people in Europe. There were an estimated 100 million Indians in the Americas and only an estimated 70 million white people in Europe. But by the 1880s, that population of indigenous people had been reduced by 98%. But even with all of that reality, we have this thing that there was no such word as genocide until white people kill white people as they did in Germany and the rest of Europe. And so here we have this thing that they said this war was fought for democracy, to deal with the Nazis who were killing Jews. And of course, Hitler has become the greatest criminal in all human history. But if the truth would be told, what they would have to say is that Churchill made Hitler look like a Boy Scout, because Churchill and the British bragged about the fact that they constituted an empire upon which the sun never set, which meant that from their perspective, they were bragging about the fact that they had more slaves than anybody on the planet Earth. But what Hitler did that was the criminal act was he treated white people the way the white world were treating Africans and Indians and everybody else around the world, and this was the thing that was an unpardonable act by Hitler. And that means to me that this whole concept of Nazism and fascism cannot be used as a criteria to talk to me about democracy. Because if you want to find somebody who has committed crimes against the peoples of the world, you don't have to go to Hitler. You can start with Columbus and Thomas Jefferson and George Washington and the rest of them as far as African and other oppressed peoples are concerned. This is the reality that we really need to understand. This is the reality that we need to understand. So I don't measure anything that's happening to African or other oppressed peoples around the world about some contest between white people about who was going to control the rest of the world. We don't do that. But what happened, of course, is the Second Imperialist War did happen. And it changed the structure of the world economy when it happened. And so America, what we call America today, became the most powerful country in the world. And it had this crucial problem it had to solve. And the problem was, where was it going to get the workers that it now needed to transform the raw materials that it was bringing from Europe, from colonies which were previously controlled by Europe? Where were the workers going to come from to transform these raw materials into finished products? Are you with me? Who was going to take the bauxite that they're now getting from places like Guyana and West Africa? Who was going to take the cocoa beans that they were getting from West Africa and transform it into something useful? In the past, what they would do is go to Eastern Europe to get workers and bring them here. In fact, that's where the term hunky came from the Hungarians. And it was white people fighting against other white people who were Hungarians who came up with the term hunky to describe those Hungarians and actually fought them in the streets over jobs. So that's where they previously went when they needed workers. But they couldn't go to Eastern Europe to do it now because Eastern Europe had become part of what they refer to as the Soviet bloc. So in order to get the workers they need to transform the raw materials into finished products, they went down south. They had to go down south. But in order to get workers from down south, they had to attack the basic relations of production that occurred in the south. And by that, I mean this. In this country, there were two means of capitalist production. In the north, capitalist production was capital intensive, which meant that it occurred in factories using machineries and what have you. In the south, capitalist production was labor intensive, which meant that it was just a lot of back-breaking work, planting crops, harvesting crops, clearing swamps, laying railroad ties, and the rest of it, and we were the ones who were doing that work. Now, you had a situation where the economy of the world was changing, and now these raw materials are coming into factories, and what the dominant capitalist forces in this country, which were financial capitalists, needed was somebody to put in those damn factories to turn that raw materials into finished products that they could sell here and around the world, including back to Europe and back to Japan, which had now been devastated by the war. So how were they going to do this? They couldn't simply do it because the southern white capitalists were not going to willingly allow African people to leave. In fact, it was during a time where most of our parents were and grandparents were sharecroppers in the South. You couldn't leave if you wanted to leave. In fact, people had to literally sneak out of the South, leave at midnight and what have you, to escape from sharecropping, because if they caught you leaving often, they would put you in the chain gang and then rent you out to the same plantation that you were trying to get away from. That was the kind of democracy that African people were experiencing in this country at that time. So these southern capitalists were not about to simply allow African people to go work in factories up north, are not about to allow African people even to work in factories that white capitalists, the other capitalists, wanted to open up in the South. And so in order to facilitate that, they had to have a revolution that would transform, that would change the relations of production, that would make it possible for African people to work in the factories, to be able to leave the South and go to the North, to be able to get the education necessary in order to work in factories, and that was an absolute necessity. But they had to have a revolution that would not overturn the entire system, a revolution that was limited to serve the interests of the capitalists, ultimately, who wanted access to our labor. And so it was based on this that we saw the rise of the civil rights movement in this country. And the civil rights movement represented an alliance between the liberal sector, of the white ruling class in this country, and between the liberal sector of the African petty bourgeoisie or middle class. That's what the civil rights movement was. And the civil rights movement, the liberal sector of the African petty bourgeoisie, wanted this civil rights movement because they assumed that if they had basic democratic rights, if African masses had the right to vote, then they'd have the ability to be elected, because they assumed that they could integrate into the capitalist system if African masses had the right to vote. We were living in places throughout the South where often there were majority African communities, where black people could not register, black people could not vote, black people could not run for office, and the only criteria for running for office and being in power was that you be white. And so they had often illiterate, tobacco-chewing, backwoodsmen, white people who were functioning as sheriff and mayor and what have you, had no education. In the same cities, we had brothers who had sometimes studied not only at places like Tuskegee and Howard, but Harvard and throughout Europe and what have you, and had to get off the sidewalk just because some tobacco-chewing backwoodsman was coming in the same direction. Couldn't run for office, couldn't do anything, and lived a life of terror. They knew that they could do a better job running, not only running the county, running the city, but they felt they could integrate into the capitalist system if the masses of African people had a right to vote. And so we found this alliance emerging between the liberal sector of the white ruling class, based mostly in the North, and the liberal sector of the African petty bourgeoisie or middle class. And the civil rights movement was born off this. This is the basis for the fact that the civil rights movement was based tactically and strategically on philosophical nonviolence. No matter what happens, that we would always be nonviolent, because the civil rights movement was funded by the liberal sector of the white ruling class. And they were not about to fund a movement that could actually overturn the entire system. They were not about to fund a movement where African people would actually pick up a gun and fight back. It was an absolute necessity that the leadership of that movement called for nonviolence under any circumstances, no matter what crimes, what atrocities committed against our people, our community, our children, our women, we would be nonviolent. In fact, the civil rights movement used to have classes on getting beaten. If you couldn't go on a demonstration with the civil rights movement without first going through this class where they throw stuff on you just like it was the white people who were going to throw it on you, where they smack you around and talk bad to you. They wanted to make sure that we were going to act right when we got out there with the white folks. And the reality, of course, is we didn't need any classes on getting beaten. We were experts at that. But that's exactly what was happening with that movement. Some people mystify that. They say the civil rights movement was based on nonviolence because Martin Luther King was a Christian. And that's total and absolute nonsense. The reality is the Ku Klux Klan was also a Christian organization. And their Christianity told them to lynch and kill black people who wanted freedom. And King's Christianity told us to nonviolently be lynched and be killed in the process of having freedom. Had nothing to do with Christianity, had nothing to do with religion. The reality is that it was a movement that was funded by a sector of the ruling class that did not want to see itself overturned, just wanted to see another sector of it moved out of the way so that capitalism could grow and flourish in this country. Y'all with me on that? I know that ain't the fairy tale that we often get told. Because the fairy tale is there was a good white liberal who woke up one day, decided he was going to love us. And then there were some good black people who believed in nonviolence and just marched off. But there were objective material conditions at work, and we need to understand them if we want to talk about how we free ourselves. And so that movement kicked off. And the problem, of course, is that the movement went much further than anybody thought it would go. The people who constructed such an alliance as that made the assumption that the average African masses of sharecroppers and what have you were simply malleable, backwards, ignorant folk who could simply be led any way that the ruling class and the black liberals wanted them to be led. But the truth of the matter is this, that the people, any people, once in the process of changing the world, become changed themselves. And people who one day were simply uneducated sharecroppers who were out trying to change the world, they became transformed. And they stood up like people like Fannie Lou Hamer and people like Willie Ricks and others, sung and unsung heroes, and they made a tremendous movement and found and discovered their own interests, and their own interests were separate and distinct from the interests either of the liberal sector of the white ruling class or the African petty bourgeoisie. So that by 1964, when the first civil rights bill, the civil rights bill was passed, and then 1965, when the Voting Rights Act was passed, it all should have been over effectively because the basic democratic rights that the movement was struggling for had been achieved. But it hadn't been achieved for the masses of African workers and poor people who were able to determine that, yes, the preachers and the lawyers and the rest of it, you got what you want, but what we want and need is black power. 1966, the demand for black power came out of Mississippi, of all places. The demand for black power came out of Mississippi. And the demand for black power did more than anything. What it did was change or expose the real nature of the struggle that we were involved in and made it clear that we are not out here trying to struggle to change anybody's mind. What we want is power over our own lives. And when the movement determined that the issue was power, what it did was put itself in the same level as all the other revolutionary struggles of oppressed people happening everywhere in the world. It became an anti-colonial movement. At the juncture, the issue became one of power. When it said power, it united with the struggles being led by people like Che Guevara, not only throughout Latin America, but in Africa, and all the oppressed and fighting peoples of the world. That became a crucial issue. It became a crucial determination. It concretized in the real world what the struggle was about. And so that we came to understand that the issue is not to make your oppressor like you and struggling against his racism. The issue is not running around trying to educate the oppressor to stop doing something bad to you. The issue was to get the power over your life so that no matter what the oppressor thinks about you, he can't do nothing to hurt you. In fact, if you want to, you can do a job on him. That's what became clear to us. And so the movement achieved that amount of clarity. And of course, the fundamental thing was that it was a movement that took its ideological leadership from Malcolm X, and I mean explicitly Malcolm X. I want to be clear about that. I'm not talking about any other connection Malcolm might have had any other time. I'm talking about Malcolm X was the ideological leader of this movement. And to further the point that I want to make, because some people like to attribute Malcolm X and what he said to Elijah Muhammad. I do not. And I do not do that because Elijah didn't do that. In fact, Elijah kicked Malcolm out of the organization precisely because he did not represent what Elijah did. And there was a tremendous split in the movement at that time with folk who believed in revolution. Because you ain't never heard nobody from the Nation of Islam before or since Malcolm X talk about the revolution, the revolution. And that was the thing that distinguished, that was the thing that drew the line in the organization. Somebody was talking about revolution, and Malcolm was that person, and he became the ideological father, if you will, of this movement that we are dealing with even today. In fact, Malcolm had been killed by the imperialist precisely because of where he was trying to take the movement even before it matured to the place that it matured. Malcolm was assassinated, but it was too late. And so by 1966, the movement was talking about power, black power over our own lives. By 1967, we saw the rise of the Black Panther Party, which took the struggle even further, and recognizing that, and which was an organization immediately and explicitly informed by Malcolm X, influenced by Malcolm X, who told us that every African, since it's legal to have a shotgun, every African should have a shotgun in his house. And he also said that we should form rifle clubs. Didn't he say this? We should form rifle clubs all over this country. And Huey P. Newton heard Malcolm X and formed the Black Panther Party and was able to say that it was the influence of Malcolm X and, of course, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, which also was influenced by Malcolm X, that gave rise to the Black Panther Party and what it stood for. And so we saw the rise of the Panther Party, and we saw tremendous anxiety occurring in this country, so much so that J. Edgar Hoover, who was then the executive director of the FBI, which is one of the secret political police in this country, characterized the Black Panther Party as the greatest threat to the internal security of the United States since the Civil War. Not Gaddafi, not Saddam Hussein, not the Russians, but ordinary African working class folk, most of whom lived in housing projects and had to use public transportation to get from one part of a city to the other. This was the force that Hoover declared was the greatest internal threat to the security of this country. And that's a statement about the potential for the power that we look for. And that's a statement about where the power should be looked for. It is in the masses of African workers and poor people who, given organization and ideological clarity, can achieve anything. That's the thing that Hoover and the FBI recognized. Unfortunately, not too many of our leaders today recognize that. And that's also the basis for most of the attacks that we see happening on the African workers and poor people in the housing projects and every place else, because that's where the revolution is in. So the FBI, we know that various military intelligence organizations were involved in the struggle to crush our revolutionary movement. We know that revolution became the main trend in this country, that it was the Black Revolution once unleashed, which gave rise to virtually every other progressive entity that occurred. It was the Black Revolution even that took the white woman out the kitchen and white homosexuals out the closet. It was the Black Revolution that energized the movements of other oppressed peoples, the indigenous peoples in this country. It was a powerful and profound revolutionary movement that shook this country to its very foundation, that shook the system to its very foundation. I shall never forget the sight after they had assassinated Martin Luther King, and I'm talking about the federal government, after they assassinated Martin Luther King, and the rebellions which emerged throughout this country by African people. I shall never forget the sight of them circling the White House with tanks, with the assumption that the Africans had achieved enough organization that we might actually be able to seize the White House. They know where the power is. Unfortunately, too often, we forget where the power is. And what we saw was a movement to cut and undermine the revolution, a movement that created assassinations, created what we refer to as a counterinsurgency. And a counterinsurgency is a military term. And it's a military term of warfare that uses every form. It uses psychological warfare. It uses actual armed struggle. It uses economic warfare. And the primary strategic aims of counterinsurgency is resource and population control. To control the resources, to control the population that they are dealing with. And we saw after the defeat of the Black Revolution of the 60s, we saw Richard Milhouse Nixon reward the man who was the architect of the FBI's counterintelligence program, COINTELPRO, whose name was William Sullivan. Nixon rewarded Sullivan by sending him to a post in Southeast Asia where he was supposed to make a war against drugs. Southeast Asia was an area that was called the Golden Triangle. It was called that because most of the world's heroin was coming from that area. So here the man who killed Fred Hampton, the man who was responsible for Rizzo attacking the Panther Party here in New York and stripping them naked before the press so that you would be demoralized and feel like there was no win. Now this man was sent to Southeast Asia to fight a war against drugs that we didn't even know existed. And shortly after Sullivan got to Southeast Asia, he recruited people like G. Gordon Liddy, you ever hear of him? E. Howard Hunt, Richard Secord, who was recently involved in the drug scandal with Oliver North. They became a part of an organization that he created, the acronym for which is ODEAL, that became the Drug Enforcement Administration. This was the birth of the Drug Enforcement Administration. This was also the origin of the heroin epidemic that hit our communities as soon as the Panthers and other revolutionary organizations were taken off the street. This was the source of the heroin epidemic. This was the time when the United States government was involved in a counterinsurgency war against the heroic and courageous people of Vietnam. And so on the one hand, they were making war against the people of Vietnam, and they were making war against the African people here with another counterinsurgency in the form of heroin. And the heroin was everywhere. There was not a city that was too small or too rural if African people were there for heroin not to be there. And so that's what we saw emerge, and this was around 71, 72, the year of the founding of the African People's Socialist Party, when as far as they were concerned, it was supposed to all be over. Then what we saw was in 1979, of course, the Sandinistas, the FSLN, rode into Managua and rode into power in Managua, overthrowing Somoza, the Somoza regime that had been put in place by the U.S. government. And when the Sandinistas rode into Managua, then the strategic counterinsurgent efforts of the United States government shifted from Southeast Asia into Latin America. And guess what? Just so happens in Latin America, most of the world's cocaine is grown and harvested. And guess what? All of a sudden, African people lost our taste for heroin, and suddenly we got involved in cocaine. But it wasn't just cocaine. It wasn't cocaine. It was a derivative of cocaine. It was something that somebody went into a laboratory and created so that it would be cheap enough for massive distribution throughout the African community. So now there's a counterinsurgency war that's being initiated against the Nicaraguan people in the Nicaraguan Revolution, and another war that's being initiated against the African people here in the form of crack cocaine chemical warfare. This is what we are talking about. The United States government did it. Recently, in August 20 of 1996, a white guy out of San Jose, working for the San Jose Mercury News, kicked off a series of newspaper articles revealing the FBI involvement in creating crack cocaine epidemic in our country, in our communities, rather. And this was something that came out of San Jose. Just so happened, you know, San Jose is about 45 minutes away from Oakland, where we waged struggles from 1980-something up until now exposing the fact that it's the United States government that is the pusher in our communities. In fact, we raised the slogan after they assassinated Huey P. Newton, "Who killed Huey? Don't tell no lie." It's the government, the FBI, and then the other slogan, because they wanted to tie Huey to the drug question, was that what we understood was that the White House is the crack house and Uncle Sam is the pusher man. And so, but I want you to understand this, that Gary Webb, the white guy who wrote this series of articles, he got fired from his job for that and came under serious attack from various other sources. He didn't just write some articles that appeared in the San Jose Mercury News. The reality is that along with that, especially on the internet, there was 160 pages of actual documentation. And this documentation was from court records, from interviews with people who were involved in putting the drugs in our community, from young Ricky Ross, a 19-year-old high school dropout that the CIA agent found in Los Angeles, California, a high school dropout who couldn't read. In fact, he was a tennis star in high school but had to quit, couldn't play tennis because he couldn't read. And the FBI agent found Ricky. He had never seen cocaine in his life, you understand? And a CIA agent, rather, found him and then made him into the cocaine dealer that participated in distributing crack cocaine throughout this country. But when you talk about the CIA, you know, what has to be understood is you're talking about the American government. That's the American government that did it. It's the American government that put crack cocaine in our communities. That's resulted in we don't know how many people locked up, how many people dead as a consequence. That is the American government. The CIA is the American government. The FBI was not just J. Edgar Hoover. That was the American government that was attacking us. And in this instance, it was the American government that used CIA to crush our movement, to destroy the morale of our community so that revolution would never rear its head in this country again. That was their intention. That was what it was about. And so, a movement was crushed down. We had a situation where the whole community, for years, the African community, we lived in an era that we characterized one of demoralization and defeat, where you couldn't even talk to the masses about revolution, where the people, the last memory that people had of revolution were tanks in the streets, militants being assassinated, and they would kill people in very exemplary ways, the way they killed King. Shot him in the mouth, the way they assassinated Malcolm, the way they killed Fred Hampton. They didn't have to kill any of those folk in that way. They could have fixed it so they looked like they had a heart attack. They could have fixed it so it looked like they slipped in the bathtub and cracked their skull. They could have fixed it, make it look like a car accident. But they didn't do that because J. Edgar Hoover had made the statement that what he wanted to be very clear was that to young Africans, that if you become a revolutionary, you'll be a dead revolutionary. And so it was designed to demoralize the community and create this sense of invincibility and white power that you can't fight them without dying. And we run into African people all the time. We talking about, let's get organized, let's do something. They say, well, it don't make no sense in getting organized because every time we get a leader, they kill it. That was the sentiment in our community. And people were, in many instances, terrified to sit up in a meeting like this with children and what have you, and have the door kicked in and FBI and agents and other cops running in with their guns drawn. This was common stuff, where the FBI would attack a building and would destroy the materials, where they take your newspapers and sit them in the middle of the room and set them on fire, or piss on them, or do some other kinds of things and make them, this was the terror that existed inside this country. And so this was what we've had to overcome. And now they put the crack cocaine, in our community, and it demoralized the African workers and poor people who are the heartbeat of the revolution. Let me tell you that. That's where the revolution is. And when they did this to the young African workers and poor people, then we saw all these other so-called Negro leaders who would come up attacking the community. The problem was the community. We need to atone. We need this and that. It wasn't that the government was the problem. It was the people who were the problem. And so we had to struggle against this concept that was out there, even among the African working class itself. Because what we found is that the people who were out pushing crack cocaine often thought it was their idea that they were doing it. They thought, I'm out here doing this because this is my idea, but it wasn't their idea. What the imperialists, the capitalists, what white power had done was take away all the other options and say, if you want to live, this is what you can do to live on, and put crack cocaine there. I'm not a hunter, but I'm told that in places like in the Arctic, where indigenous people sometimes might hunt a wolf, they'll take a double-edged blade and they'll put blood on the blade and they'll melt the ice and stick the handle in the ice so that only the blade is protruding, and that a wolf will smell the blood and wants to eat, and it'll come and lick the blade trying to eat. And what happens is when the wolf licks the blade, of course, he cuts his tongue and he bleeds and he thinks he's really having a good meal. He drinks and he licks and he licks, and of course he's drinking his own blood and he kills himself. That's what the imperialists did to us with crack cocaine. You've got these young brothers out there thinking that they're getting something that they're gonna make a living with. They're getting something they can buy a car, like the white people have cars. Why can't I have a car? They're getting something that they can get a piece of gold. The white people have gold. Why can't I have gold? They're getting something to get a house. The white people have a house. Why can't I have a house? And they actually think that it's something that's bringing resources to them, but they're killing themselves just like the wolf who's licking the blade, and they're slowly dying without knowing it. That's what's happening to the community. You with me on that? That's exactly and precisely what happens to the community. And instead of blaming the hunter who put the damn handle and the blade in the ice for the wolf, that what happens is the wolf gets blamed for trying to live. That's what happens in our community. You don't blame the person, the victim, you blame the oppressor. Imperialism, white power is the enemy, was the enemy when it first came to Africa and snatched up the first African, brought us here against our will, is the enemy today. That's the thing that we have to understand. And upon that, and there can't be any compromise on that. No compromise on it. I know your television got stolen, mine too. But we can't limit the discussion and the issue and the understanding to some immediate personal contradiction that we have with somebody who's victimized by imperialism. I know you got a sister or an aunt or a cousin or somebody who ripped you off because they own that stuff, but we can't limit our understanding based on our own personal relationship to it, because imperialism is making war against all of us. And he got hooked first, and he becomes an instrument of imperialism when he does what he does to us in our community. So the community is demoralized. And this is one of the most effective counterinsurgency tools that you can have, where the actual victim actually believes that he is responsible for what's going on. Where the victim, and then the victims become increasingly demoralized by his behavior, because he knows something's wrong with what he's doing. Of course, one of the things that happens too is that the crack addiction, the drug addiction, it creates political justification for militarizing our community, for taking away every right you think you won. You think you got some rights. You think that you got freedom of speech. You think you got freedom of assembly. And then, of course, they use the existence of the crack that they put in your community as a basis and justification for taking it away from you. And so now here you have Africans. 34 years ago in this country, an African who would try to register to join the Democratic Party. 34 years ago, an African in this country who would try to register to join the Democratic Party would be taken out and lynched, have his sexual organs cut off and stuffed in his mouth. Do you understand? This is America I'm talking about. 34 years ago, that was the case. 33 years ago in this country, an African couldn't drive from one part of the country to the other and stop on the highway to use a service station to pee without facing death. 33 years ago in this country. And today, they want to convince you and I that it's the African population that's the criminal population all of a sudden, and that white power has to be terrified of us. This is the circumstances that we're living with today. This is a consequence of the success of counterinsurgency. Destroy our leaders, destroy our organization, disperse the members of the organization, and then turn reality upside down. This becomes a part of the counterinsurgency, where now through the media and various other forms, they redefine the relationship, that the historical relationship that we've always had. And many of our own folk, as I said before, and particularly black leaders, unite with the definition that they create for us. So this is a struggle. And so for the totality of our existence, we've been trying to deal with the counterinsurgency. The counterinsurgency, it was not just drugs. The counterinsurgency also involved what we refer to as neo-colonialism. Some people refer to it as Negro colonialism. And neo-colonialism is white power in a black face. And it's used everywhere in the world. There's a man named Kwame Nkrumah who came up with the concept of neo-colonialism. Under old colonialism, it was real clear who was running stuff, because the white man stood on top of everything, controlled every aspect of our lives. Neo, which means new. Neo-colonialism comes about only when the masses become so politically astute that they will not accept domination by foreigners anymore. You with me on that? This ain't gonna do it. Say, kill the white man, kill the white eyes, fuck up whitey. You understand? Neo-colonialism comes about when the masses become too astute and to accept obvious foreign domination. Then it becomes necessary for them to use what they call indirect rule, neo-colonialism. Neo-colonialism is white power in a black face, white power in a brown face, white power in a yellow face. Neo-colonialism is white power in disguise, white power masquerading as something else. White power trying to look like you, white power that know how to do the walk. White power in a dashiki. And so the most significant way they utilize neo-colonialism, put it in place in this country, is through the electoral process. Look at, and some of the places where they've done it, circumstances they've done it in, helps to clarify exactly what I'm talking about. Look at Philadelphia as an example. Under the boot of this terrorist thug Rizzo, who left the planet Earth before we got organized well enough and became clear enough to help his exit. Here, a thug who I'm told that even among the pigs, that I'm told that he used a blackjack and hit a Negro pig's wife in the mouth at a party. You understand? Who bragged that he had a police department that was so vicious that it could defeat the Cuban army. Talking about this thug. And the masses of African people rising up, trying to get organized to get rid of this thug. This was the basis of a huge movement that existed in Philadelphia. Big old so-called Black United Front got created in Philadelphia around that. And who becomes the spokesperson, the helmsman for this movement? A Democratic Party hack who's never made a single move to help African people. Who all the years she's been in the Democratic Party, never stood up for African people, never stood up to Rizzo, never said feed, clothe, and house my people. All these African people got behind Wilson Good and elected him as the mayor, didn't they? I mean, people worked like hell to elect and did some fierce political work in this city. And in this city, they had a holdover, a remnant of the movement that didn't get quite wiped out, at least visibly, in dreadlocks and what have you, and everybody calling themselves Africa. And it was a real problem for the city of Philadelphia. And so when it became time to get rid of them permanently, it wasn't Rizzo. Rizzo tried it and the people pushed him back. It was Wilson Good who gave the order and bragged about it. Yes, I did it. Yes, I did, he said. I know he wrote some nonsense later
After he found out him and his ugly wife couldn't walk the streets without meeting the terrible opposition of black folks, he's trying to talk his way out of it. But I saw him on television and said, yes, I gave the order and I'd do it again. And he had a bomb drop on them African people. Why didn't he drop a bomb on Rizzo? He did it. And when he did it, it confused so many people. And people were in a state of denial because they went out and worked for this guy. They worked, worked, worked. They couldn't believe it. They made up excuses for him. You heard him say it. He didn't do it. He didn't. I'm looking at that, just like the Rodney King situation. He didn't do it. They didn't do it. Oh, don't tell me. He admitted to doing it. He bragged about it. And not only him, but a whole cabal of Negroes in that administration with him participated in it. And it confused all these massive. What would have happened if Rizzo would have dropped that bomb? Not only would there would Philadelphia have been on fire, but there wouldn't have been a city in this country with black people that wouldn't have been burning. But they could do it because of Wilson Good. That's neo-colonialism. Confuse the masses of the people. So we live at a time today where there's an estimated 10,000 black elected officials in this country today, and four times as many Negroes who have been appointed to some kinds of administrative capacity in government. And yet, the conditions of existence of African people in this country in 1998 is worse than it was in 1968 in terms of material situation. And that is the truth. And not one of the 40 or 50,000 Negroes who have some modicum of power has said, feed, clothe, and house my people. Not one. Tell me one. Not one. And neocolonialism became an effective tool. And it became a cover for white power. Well, it can't be racism because y'all got a black police chief. Ain't that what they say? You can't be racism because the mayor is black. And we agree with them. It's colonialism. It is colonialism. It is foreign domination. It is domination by a foreign and alien power over another people. That is colonialism. And a colonial power will use anybody. Hell, the British use Kenyan rifle people out of Kenya, black people. Recruited them from all over the British Empire, all over Africa. Idi Amin was a part of it, to put down revolution and resistance by other black people all over the place. But everybody was clear that it was colonialism they were fighting against, and that's a key thing for us to understand. Because you get in this racism question, you can't even explain why the hell Good dropped the bomb. You can't explain why black people have been in white people's armies to kill other black people. But it's colonialism. It is the political power that we have to fight for. We have to have the power. And damn it, let me tell you something. The issue is not whether white power, white people like you. The issue is whether you have the power so that whether they like you or not, they can't do nothing to hurt you. And guess what? When you got power, you find out a lot of people would like you who didn't like you before. If you really want somebody to like your ass, get your ass some power. Get some power and see how many friends you have overnight. I'm telling you. And that's what the struggle is about. It's about power. And so this became an important aspect of the counterinsurgency. It was drugs. And then it became this neo-colonialism, this white power in blackface that dominates our community everywhere. And so since the 1960s, since our founding in 1972, the task of our movement, our party, has been to try and rebuild the revolution, to bring the masses of African people back into political life. Do you understand? Because that is the essential character of a revolutionary period. You know you got a revolutionary period when the masses have been swept up into political life. And when I say political life, I'm not talking about chanting Run, Jesse, Run every 4 years. I'm talking about the political life that we saw during the era of the Black Panther Party, where young African men and women had taken over our community, had set up free breakfast for school children programs, had established free sickle cell anemia testing programs, had established security teams would monitor the pigs in our community, had built revolutionary consciousness among the masses of the people, had brought to them an understanding, as Huey P. Newton said, that real political power comes from the barrel of the gun. When you have a mass of people who thrown into political action, seeking to determine our own future, seeking determine that nobody shall decide what power and freedom is for us but us, saying that the power I want is a black power, it's a nappy-headed power, it's a thick-nosed power, it's a big-lip power, it's a boombox on my shoulder power. I set the terms for what I'm talking about, not the oppressor. You know what I'm saying? That's the struggle. That's the struggle. Power is the thing that we have to have and we'll be fighting for. And we've been doing this for several years. And there have been several recently good signs that help us to say that we have changed, we have moved into a new era. That we can't characterize this era that we live in today as one is defeat and demoralization. Because clearly what is happening is we have entered into an era of resistance and crisis. Crisis for the system and resistance among more and more oppressed peoples around the world. Of course, this crisis can be seen in a number of ways. And just, you know, briefly, Oklahoma City was crisis of the system itself. When a white boy would go and blow up the whole federal building and kill 160 some odd people, it's crisis. It's crisis that the system cannot even define what had happened. This crisis was the same system that would characterize Khalid Muhammad, would have the entire Congress of the United States pass a resolution condemning Khalid Muhammad because he made a statement about white people and Jews on the one hand, but a Congress that can't make a single statement about a militia after they blow up and kill 168 people. White boy did it. A crisis that was evident in the fact that they were ready to blame it on the Arab or black people or anybody that bombing, and when they found out that a white boy had done it, they couldn't even begin to talk about it. That's crisis. That's profound crisis. It's crisis that makes me say maybe we should take the guns out of the hands of young black people and put them in the hands of young white people. It's crisis when you look up and white boys go to school nowadays to kill everybody in the joint. It's crisis when the 15-year-old white boy who just did the killing, you have to sneak around his house because he's got bombs all over the place ready to blow something else up. It's crisis of the system. I'm telling you, that's what you're looking at. It's crisis. It's a part of a crisis where even white folk have concluded that the system, they can't solve their problem inside the system itself, where growing numbers of white people are armed to the teeth all over this country. Listen, it used to be a time when those white people who were armed around the country, they were patriotic and they'd kill you. They were reactionary. They're reactionary that's out there now. But they would get organized to kill you, but they would never blow up a federal building. They would never try to kill white people. They would never, unless the white people were so-called nigger lovers. They'd never try to attack the government. But now they mad with the government for the same reason, and you're central to it. But now they armed to shoot the government. They armed to kill the sheriff, to blow up the feds, and the rest of it. That is crisis that exists inside this country. And that's what we're looking at. And we also see resistance happening. And evidence of the resistance, I think, was the Million Man March, where we saw. And I want to tell you that I'm in total disagreement with what I think is the most reactionary, backwards, call that was associated with the Million Man March, that somehow black people were supposed to go to Washington, D.C., a million people, and atone for our sins. I mean, if you're going to send a million people to Washington, D.C., at least give them a brick. You understand what I'm saying? And if you go to atone for our sins, how in the hell, this is the most incredible thing I've ever heard of. How in the hell do I look in Washington? And maybe in my community, maybe I go to church, maybe I go to the park and say, I surely did. But to go to Washington, D.C., which is the headquarters of the crimes against the peoples of the world, which is the headquarters of the crimes of Africans and other oppressed people in Philadelphia and everywhere we live, and talking about I'm going there to atone for my sins. What they should have did is call for Clinton to come out with his hands up. You understand? But when you saw 2 million people show up there, it was clearly an indication that the people wanted to resist. When you saw the thousands of people come out to the Million Women's March, it was clearly a sign that people are looking for a way to resist. Although they ain't found it yet in those instances, but they're looking for resistance. And I want to tell you just briefly another thing that I think is bringing us even clearer, because this is what we're looking for, how to give some kind of leadership to the intent, to the will, to the interest of the people in resistance. In October 24th of 1996 in St. Petersburg, Florida, I heard a radio station, WHAT here, had some bad things to say about us in relationship to that. But an 18-year-old African was shot down by the police in St. Petersburg, Florida. And immediately after he was shot down, because it was 3 blocks away from our headquarters, there were members of our movement which were in the streets. And because we were in the streets, we helped the people to understand the nature of the police in our community and what that was about. And as a consequence of all of that, when all the cops were out there, what developed was immediately hand-to-hand combat with the police, between the police and the people. And then what it developed on beyond that was 2 police precincts in the community got burned to the ground, a police car got burned up, some media vehicles got burned up, and some usury exploitive white merchants got burned out of the community. And the government right away said that the reason it happened was because of the Uhuru movement, that we incited the rebellion. And because they said we incited the rebellion, they targeted the Uhuru movement that with the clear intentions to criminalize us before public opinion and then to put us in jail. But the problem was that that the black middle class, the way it usually does, it was in motion in St. Petersburg after the killing and the rebellion, and they wanted to rush down to the white folks and say, if y'all give us some money, then we won't allow these rebellions to happen anymore. But the difficulty they had was the white power had already said we started the rebellion. So they couldn't go get the money from the white folks without having a relationship with us. So that meant that now all the preachers and black business people were in a coalition with us. And that meant that if they wanted to put us in jail, they had to put the preachers and everybody else in jail. And so that created a political problem for them that made it hard for them to do. And they wrote editorials telling the preachers disassociate themselves with Omali Ishitella and the Uhuru movement because we won't renounce violence. Here they done kill this youngster in the streets and we won't renounce violence. And so they needed to find a way to get rid of us because we were having demonstrations. We wouldn't let them sweep it under the rug. It was a rebellion that had consciousness. It wasn't like LA, and it wasn't like the rebellions that had happened in Miami previously. It was clear, it was a conscious rebellion. It had revolutionary consciousness. And they wanted to get rid of the origin of that consciousness. And so on November 13, some 3 weeks after they killed Teron Lewis and the thing still going on, what they did was they sent some 30 members of a special weapons team and camouflaged outfits and carrying automatic weapons to arrest a member of our movement outside of the building for having an expired license plate. And it drew the attention of hundreds of people in the community. And so there were hundreds of Africans who were standing around watching the police. They pepper sprayed me in the face. They pepper sprayed a young woman leader of our movement in the face. And they were clearly, what they were trying to do was start a confrontation that would justify them wiping us out and getting rid of their problem once and for all. And so they just rode up and down the streets for hours with 4 and 5 in a car with a gun sticking out of the car doors and what have you. And then at about 6 o'clock, they blocked off the streets and told people that if they came to our scheduled meeting, that they put them in jail. About 6:30, they told those of us who were in the meeting hall, and there were about 100 of us, including babies and other children and women and men, they gave us 5 minutes to get out of the building. They were gonna shoot tear gas in the building. By now, there are 300 cops outside our place, you understand? There's the St. Petersburg Police Department, Pinellas County Sheriff Department, the Florida Highway Patrol.
There's Largo Police Department, Clearwater Police Department, and there were 300 cops outside in front of the place. And they said, we declared this an illegal and unlawful assembly. And then they started shooting tear gas into our building. They used all the tear gas they had in the city of St. Petersburg in that building. They had a helicopter, they had a light airplane. It looked just like MOVE all over again. And people, that's what people on the outside saying. And they're just shooting tear gas. They used the tear gas canisters that set the tree on fire behind the building. They were shooting the canisters, trying to set the roof on fire by shooting the tear gas canisters up on the roof. And what happened was that the brothers and sisters in the community got their t-shirts and tied them around their faces, and they picked up bricks, bottles, and automatic weapons, and they confronted the cops. They shot down a helicopter, wounded two cops, and chased 300 cops out of the community, and that's why I'm able to be having this discussion with you here on today. So it's just another sign of the resistance that's trying to emerge. We have to take advantage of this era. Some people are. That's why you see all these marches talking about everybody's got a march. And I'm waiting now for the crippled people march or something, you know, because there's a march of every constituency. But the problem is that though this system is in crisis, and though we see elements of resistance emerging, that I am confident within a very short period of time will characterize our general struggle. In fact, this may be a very interesting summer that's coming up for us right now. The problem is that this resistance has to be given shape and form. The problem is that it's not enough for the oppressor to be in a state of crisis. That's not enough. In fact, sometimes crisis makes this guy more desperate and more reactionary than at other times. Look at what he's doing, sweeping the streets and denying people basic democratic rights, locking up people for everything. I'm told now in Philadelphia, if you're homeless, they put you in jail, and if you can't pay the fine, then they take away your right to have a house. I mean, I'm most vicious kind of oppressive laws they're putting out all around this country. And of course, the prisons are full, stuffed with African people everywhere. And so this is a consequence of crisis. And believe me when I tell you that, because when the system works well, they don't have to do that. The system, they only have to lock you up. They only have to use these means when the system is not working well. And they have a crisis, and they know they have a crisis. Now, what we have a responsibility to do is to become organized. We have to build revolutionary organization. We have to go into revolutionary organization. We have to support efforts like the National People's Democratic Uhuru Movement. That is essentially an organization that's fighting to try to push back the state to give us the democratic space that we need to pursue the revolutionary interests and aspirations of the masses of African people here and around the world. Thank you very much. Uhuru.